हेलो
एंड गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन।
एम आई ऑडिबल एंड विजिबल टू ऑल ऑफ यू? कैन यू हियर मी? मैं ऑडिबल एंड विजिबल? मैं नो वेदर आई एम ऑडिबल और विजिबल। कैन यू सी मी और नॉट? वेव ऑफ हैंड और एनीथिंग विल हेल्प मी फाइंडिंग आउट वेदर आई एम ऑडिबल और विजिबल। यू कैन हियर मी? एनीवन? ओके फाइन। सो वी स्टार्ट टुडेज क्लास। With what we had done in the previous class, I think in the previous class we were doing a work done by force, and I gave you a formula for work done by force, and that formula was work done by force is integral of fx dx plus integral of plus fy dy plus fz dz. Do we remember this? That was a formula that we had derived, and we had seen that we can use it for conservative forces. We can use this formula for conservative forces when we don't have anything that is a non-conservative force. We can use this formula. Then we came to the point that, sir, how will we understand whether a force is conservative or not? Do you have any idea? Did you find out whether a force is conservative or not? How do you find out whether a force is conservative or not? Any idea anyone has? Well, if you can find out this one, this is condition number one. This is condition number two, and this is condition number three, where this delta stands for partial derivative. So partial derivative of x with respect to y should be equal to partial derivative of f of y with respect to x, and so on. If all these three conditions are met, then we can say that the force we are dealing with is a conservative force. And if it is a conservative force, we can use this formula to find out whether it is, to find out the work done by that force. Am I clear? Let us take for an example one force. This F vector is 3x square I hat plus 2y j hat plus z cube k hat. Here, as you can see, this is not a constant force because force is varying with x, y, and z, so it is not a constant force. But you can see this term x only comes with I, this term y only comes with j, and this term z only comes with k. Even without calculating anything, you can say that this force is a conservative, because if you find out the partial derivative of x with respect to y, I know that you know the meaning of partial derivative. Partial derivative of x fx with respect to y means what? You have to only consider y as variable, rest everything is a constant. Partial derivative with respect to x, only x is variable, rest everything is constant. Partial derivative with respect to z, only z is variable, everything else is a constant. Now, if I find the partial derivative of 3x square with respect to y, it will be 0. If I find the partial derivative of 2y with respect to x or z, it will be 0. So, all of these three terms, if I find out, will be 0, 0, 0, and hence, this type of force will always be a conservative force. Do we understand this? Can I have some raised hand that we understand this, sir? That any force of this nature, or any force, you can find out whether it's conservative or not with these three conditions. Can I have your raised hands that we understand this, sir? When you tell me with your raised hand that you understand this, to find out whether a force is conservative or not. Let us take one more example of a force and find out whether it's a conservative force or not. I'm very peculiar about color, so I must use blue. F. Now look at this force. 2xy I hat plus x square j hat. Let me not put the term of y. Let me not put the term of k. So there is no k, so you don't have to differentiate. You don't have to do step number 2 and you don't have to do step number 3 because there is no k. You only need to check one thing. That is step number 1. Equation number 1. You find the partial derivative of fx. So you have to find del of fx with respect to del of y. Del of fx is partial derivative of 2xy. I'm writing integral sign and I'm writing partial derivative. Partial derivative of 2xy with respect to y. 2x is a constant. Y is a variable. Derivative of y with respect to y will be 1. So the partial derivative of this thing will come as 2x. Partial derivative of fx with respect to y is coming as 2x. If I could now find out the partial derivative of f of y with respect to x, partial derivative of f of y with respect to x. So I have to differentiate partially this with respect to x. So this is the partial derivative of x squared with respect to x. The only variable is x. So the derivative of x squared will be 2x. As you can see, 2x and 2x both are same. And hence, this force becomes a conservative force. This force becomes a conservative force. And hence, we can find out the work done by this force by the equation which I have written here, because it will not depend on path. Can I have reason that we understand this? You will not see this in books. You will not find this in any book. So please tell me with raised hands that you have understood this. Vijay sir, what about Dikshit, Ashrit, Saiteja? Have you understood? Bhojaraju, have you understood this? What I have done here? I found out whether a given force is conservative or not. And now what I'm going to do is find out the work done by this force. And I think this was the question that I gave to you. So what I'll do is, we'll now find out the work done by force number 1 and work done by force number 2, knowing that all of these are conservative forces. So the first force was, question number 1, the first force was 3x squared 2yz cube. So the force was, so the work done was integral of 3x squared dx. It can be integrated easily. Plus, you can now separate it, 2y dy. It can be integrated very nicely, very easily. Plus, the last integral is z cube. It has to be integrated with dz. You can integrate it. The value of x, the limits of x will be given from where to where you need to do it. The limits of y will be given. You can simply integrate this and you will get the answer for question number 1. This was the previous slide, Dikshit. This was the first force. 3x square I 2yj z cube k. Man, this thing is flickering. Okay. 3x square I 2yj z cube k. And it can easily be integrated, as we have seen. It can easily be integrated. Just give me some time. I'll just try to check this one out, what is happening with this video. Meanwhile, I just adjust my video. You just have a look at how I have done this. That's how I have done this. Let me set this one out. What is wrong with this? Okay. I think I fixed this. Okay. So that was the first force. 3x square I hat, 2yj hat, z cube k hat. You can easily integrate it with respect to x, y, and z. not a problem. You can find out the answer. Let us talk about question number 2, where we have to find out the integral of the second force to find out the work done. Now, the second force was 2xy I hat plus x square j hat. So it is the integral of 2xy dx plus x square dy. Now, if I integrate them separately, it is impossible to integrate them because I have x here and dy here, and I don't know the relation between x and y. So doing it separately will be impossible. Just apply some common sense and I would be able to do it. What will I do? I will take this and integrate it separately. I think we have done it in the previous class. So what do I do if I integrate 2xy dx, assuming that y is a constant, so it will be integral of x dx, x square by 2, 2 say 2 cancel, it will be x square y. Here I have assumed that y is a constant. Similarly, I integrate x square dy and I assume that x is a constant, only y is variable. I integrate this, I will end up with this. I think I told you in the last class. So basically what I say is derivative of x square y, if I differentiate them, then I will have 2xy dx plus x square dy. So if I take this d here, it will become integral. So integral of this entire thing actually becomes x squared y. So this is how I have integrated it. That is the integral. Now we can simply put the limits of x and y together. When you put the limits of x and y together, you should get the value of work done by this force. We could do this. This thing is only possible when it is a conservative force, because if it is not a conservative force, this method does not work. One more example I would like to give you here. Question number 3, whatever you call it. Let me call this F vector of F force is YZ I hat plus XZ J hat plus XY K hat. Find out whether this force is conservative or not. Find out whether this force is conservative or not. And then find out the work done in moving an object from 1, 2, 3, point A to point B. Let me call it as 3, minus 1, 2. Find out if force is conservative or not. And then find out the work done by this force in moving an object from A to B. Can you do it? Okay, whether this force is conservative or not, yes or no, I will leave that test to you. You should be able to find out whether this force is conservative or not. I know that this force is conservative, so this is definitely a conservative force. How will you find out whether it's conservative or not? You can go back to the slide. Check these conditions, number 1, number 2, number 3, all of them will be coming same. So this is a conservative force. Now, if this is a conservative force, how do you do it? You don't have to look at the path. You can simply say work done by this force will be integral of fx dx. Fx is yz dx plus xz dy plus xy dz. How to integrate them? You have dx here, dy here, and dz. You just take them separately and see what is the integral of each of them, assuming the other two are constant. And when you see, all of these will have the same integration. The integral will be x, y, z. When you integrate all of these three, assuming the other two to be constant, you will get x, y, z. So basically, they are saying that derivative of x, y, z, if you find the derivative of x, y, z, it is definitely first two functions into derivative of the third one plus first and the third one, the derivative of second one, plus first and second one, the derivative of third one. So basically, if I take d here, if I put integral here, integral of this entire thing becomes xyz. So this is simply xyz. And now you put the limits of all the three terms together, starting from 1, 2, 3. The lower limit is 1, 2, 3. The upper limit is 3, minus 1, and 2. And this is how you can get the answer to this one. Do you understand this? Can I have some reason that we have understood this? Do you understand this? Can I have some reason that we understand this? Or shall I repeat? Okay. So now we know that this is how you can find out the work done by any conservative force. If you have a non-conservative force, then what you got to do? I'll give you one example and then we'll see how will you find out the work done by a non-conservative force. Let me say a force F is given by 2x. Let me take 2xy I hat plus xj hat. This is some force. You have to find the work done by this force. And let us say from where to where you have to find the work done. So I'm giving you the points. You have to find the work done This is 1, 0. This is 1, 1. This point is B. This point is C. This is 0, 1. So you have to find the work done by this force from A to B. You find the work done by this force from A to B in three paths. Path number one is this path from O to A and A to B. This is path number one. Path number two is the green path. First, you will go from O to C, and then you will go from C to B. This is path number two. Path number C will be the straight path like this. Remember, looking at this, we can find out that this is a conservative force. This is not a conservative force. Work done will depend on path. Your turn. Can you find out the work done by this force? And how will you do it? How will you do it? Any idea? Okay, what I'll do is I'll do one for you and then I'll leave the rest that you can do it. Let me go for path number one. Path number one. Let me go for path number one. So first of all, I will find work done from O to A. Work done from O to A. Now look very carefully. I have to look at the path. From O to A, one force is along I. So this force will do work. This component will do work. One force is along J. This will not do any work. So I'm not concerned about D. Not concerned about J part. The only thing that I'm concerned about is the X part, the I wala part, which is along X axis. Now in this, we have 2 times X into Y. It's a variable force. But as you can see, the value of y in from O to A, the value of y is constant, is zero, in fact. The value of y is zero. This y is zero from path O to A. So this force basically becomes zero. The work done from O to A by this force is going to be zero. Do you understand this? Can I have some reason that you understand this, sir? From O to A. Right. Okay. Let us come from A to B. A to B is along y axis. So this x-axis wala force, wala component will not do any work because they are perpendicular. Forget about it. Now let us look at y-axis. Y-axis ka wala force is x into j. Now x is a constant and x is equal to 1 from a to b. X is equal to 1. So this force is simply 1 in the upward direction. 1 newton in the upward direction. 1 newton in the upward direction. Are we getting this? This force which is doing work from A to B is 1 newton in the upward direction. Can I have some raised hand that we understand this, sir? 1 newton in the upward direction. And the displacement is also 1. So 1 into 1, the work done will be 1 joule. Do you understand this? Raise hands. So the total work done from O to B in this path is going to be 1 joule. Yes or no? Yes or no? Raise hands. Yes or no? Good. Let us now do one more path. Let us do path number 2. Let us do path number 2. So path number 2, first I will have to go from O to C. O to C. Now O to C is going along y-axis. So this x wala component will not do any work. Only y component will do work. Y component is x into j and x is 0. So this one becomes 0. The work done from O to C is 0. Are we getting this point? Or it is getting too much? Too tough? Raise hands will give me more confidence that we are on the same path, same track. Same path, same track. Okay. Now let us go from path C to B and see if you are doing things with example, conservative forces with example, to understand that they are path dependent. I mean, they are path independent and non-conservative forces are path dependent. C is going to come right now. From C to B, we are moving along x-axis. So this J component is useless. Take out this J component. Look at X and Y. It is a variable force, but Y is a constant, right? Y is a constant and Y constant is 1. So it becomes 2x. The force becomes 2x. So we integrate it dx and x is varying from 0 to 1. Are you getting this? Are we getting this? Are we getting this? Calculate the integral. X dx integral is x squared by 2. 2 so 2 will get cancelled. So it will be x squared. Integration from 0 to 1. And the answer would be 1 joule. And what do we find here is it is coming same. So we might think, sir, even if I go in this path or even if I go in that path, the answer is coming same. The answer is coming same because we are lucky. Nothing else. The answer is coming same because we are just lucky and nothing else. Okay. Now, can you do the third path? Can you do the third path? Third path, which is straight path C. Which is straight path C. Path C or path 3. Can anyone do path 3? Path 3. What is the equation of path 3? What is the equation of path 3? The equation of path 3 is y is equal to x. Yes or no? It is inclined at an angle of 45 degrees. Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes or no? Do you understand this? Yes or no? Okay. Now, how do I find the work done? Now, I use the formula. Work done is integral of fx dx plus integral of fy dy. I use this formula. Now see, fx dx. So it is 2xy dx. This kind of integral plus integral of x dy. Now you say, sir, how will I find 2xy dx kind of integral? You can find 2xy dx kind of integral because here you know the relation between y and x because you know the path. Because you know the path, you know the relation. And the relation is y is equal to x. So instead of y, here you can put x. Instead of x, here you can put y. Beautiful, na? Instead of y in the first one, you can put x. Instead of x in the second one, you can put y. Now you can integrate and see the answer. So the first integral becomes x squared dx integral. That will be x cubed by 3 multiplied by 2. 2 by 3 x cubed into 1 from 0 to 1. So answer will be 2 by 3 for the first integral plus y dy integral, y squared by 2, y varying from 0 to 1. So it becomes half. So the answer in the third case is 2 by 3 plus half. The answer in the first case was 1 joule different. The answer in the second case was different because I made the question and because of maths, both the parts were coming same. If I could have just taken this 2 off from this equation, the answer would have been different. But I just put 2. Are you getting my point that the work done by this conservative force, even if you do this conservative force by any path, your answer will always be same. By any path you do, your answer will be same. But for non-conservative force, you have to take into account what is the path in which work done is sought. Am I clear? Can we move on with lives ahead of us? Is there anything else that is troubling you? Am I clear with this point that I have made? Okay, so that was all about work done by this force. I have told you enough about this. I think we have definitely solved this question. So this is no use. Work done is integral of f dot ds. So it is basically the area under the graph. So it is not rocket science to understand that. You can find out the area from the graph. If the area is above x-axis, you can call it positive. It is below x-axis, you can call it negative. I hope you understand this. Yes or no? Yes or no? So here they have given a... How do we find whether the force is conservative? I told you that, Dikshit. I told you. You find the partial derivative. Partial derivative of fx with respect to y should be equal to partial derivative of f of y with respect to x. Didn't I tell you? Do you know partial derivatives? How do you find out partial derivatives? You have to find partial derivatives. I told you. Yes, so I gave you this equation. Didn't I give you this equation? Didn't I give you this equation? All these three results should come same. Partial derivative of fx with respect to y should be same as partial derivative of fy with respect to x. All these three conditions should be met. If these three conditions meet, then the force becomes conservative in nature. If any of these conditions does not meet, it becomes non-conservative force. Am I clear? Do we understand this? Clear? Chalo, let us again move back to what we were doing. We were here. So they are given an example here. Force is this thing. You don't have to find out the graph. You can just integrate it with dx and just integrate it and get your answer. This is a one-dimensional force. This is only varying along x-axis. So you can do it. Force is varying with respect to x. So it's a simple question. You can just put it as fx dx integral from where to where x is varying from 0 to 2. You can do it this way, or they have done it by the graph ka area ka way. I don't think you will have this much of time to draw the graph. So we can just use the tarika that I have told you, work done by a variable force. I have told you so many work done. This is all. See this one. Example 13. Is this a conservative force or is this a non-conservative force? Is this a conservative force or is a non-conservative force? Xi plus 2y. I told you, if x is coming only with I and y is coming only with j, it's a conservative force. So you can straight away use the formula. Remember this or not? Conservative. Yes, Dikshit. Well done. This is conservative. So you can straight away use fx dx. Fy dy integral. don't have to do anything else. Okay. Now, this is very simple. A time-dependent force is applied. You have to find the work done by this force. I hope you can do this. Work done is f dot dx. F co is written in terms of t. Then dx is written in terms of v dt. So you can solve it. You can find velocity as a function of time. You can also do it this way. So whenever something is given this way, you can use this formula. F work done is power, integral of power into dt. You know this? Did I tell you this? No. Good that I did this question. Did I tell you this formula of work done by this force? So this power becomes F dot V. So F dot V into dt. Okay. Okay. Do we understand this? So you can use this. Am I clear? Do we understand this or not? Okay. Okay, take it. Work done by spring force. Work done by spring force is k square by 2. You know this, right? You might get confused at times how you will get, in what case this work done is positive, in what case this work done is negative. So basically, what we are trying to understand here is, what is the work done by this force? Normally, whenever a question of this nature comes, you will be finding out questions like this, where this will be a spring and this will be a mass. Now, instead of taking this as work done by this force, it's better to take it as the potential energy of the spring. And if you take it as potential energy of the spring, you will never be confused with the positive and negative signs, because potential energy of the spring is always half kx squared. It is never negative. So whenever you are encountered with a problem of finding the work done in case of a spring, do not take it as work done for the spring. It is always better to take it as potential energy of the spring, because then you will not be faced with this problem of plus and minus. Because many a time it becomes difficult for you to understand when is the work done by the spring force positive, when is the work done by the spring force negative, whether the spring is getting compressed, it is positive, whether the spring is getting expanded, it is negative, you don't know. And in the tension of the examination hall, you might make a stupid mistake. So I would request you not to do it as work done by the spring force. You can always do it as the potential energy stored in the spring. Do we understand that? Can I have reason that whenever a problem of spring comes, we will not try to do it by work done of the spring force. We'll always try to do it by the potential energy of the spring. Do we have a consent on this? Okay. Great. Work done by constant forces. I've told you all the constant forces are conservative forces. So you can straight away use that formula. It does not depend on path. So you do it this way or you do it this way. Same answer. So work done by gravity will be mgh. You know that. It's very simple. Work done by tension of a string. We have already done that. Right? Done that or not? We had used this. We have used this principle in finding out the relation, constraint relation between this block and this block. Do you remember that constraint relation? Can you tell me what is the constraint relation between this block and this block? Assuming that this block is going down and the other block is going up. What is the constraint relation? Right. In fact, this is a question that they've asked. The velocity of block A of the system is VA at any instant. Calculate the velocity of block B. So this is moving with the velocity VA downwards. What will be the velocity VB upwards? Can you tell me? How will you find it out? Remember the constraint relation? Work done by the tension of the string. Tension of the string is zero. Remember that? we did it in constancy. If I call this tension as T, this becomes 2T, this becomes 4T, this becomes 8T. Then you find out a total tension on this. We assume that this is going up. This is 8 plus 12 plus 2, 14, 15T, 15T upwards. T is also upwards, it is also upwards. So 15T multiplied by X, the velocity of B. And this is T downwards, so minus T into velocity of A. So you will have this velocity of A is 15 times the velocity of B. We got this? Do we understand this? And this is the best way to find out the constant relation for this type of questions. Do we understand this? I'm not getting any responses from your end. Do we understand this, everyone? This is the way I told you to find out the string constraint. Yes or no? Brijesh has raised hand. Brijesh understands this probably. What about the others? Jayant also remembers it. Okay, that is good. Okay, so we understand this. Great. See, any question in work, power, and energy, you should be able to do it because it's going to be one that we can do it. Okay. I think these are simple questions. You should be able to do it. Work done by friction. Again, work done is frame dependent. So you must also understand from where, from which frame you are trying to find out. This is a simple question. So please find out the work done in the given figure by friction. You might get confused. So that is why I'm asking you this. This is smooth and you have a friction of 0.5. Mu of 0.5. Work done by force applied. Work done by friction force on B by A during displacement. It has been not asked with respect to which frame. So we'll assume that it will be with respect to ground. It will be with respect to ground frame. So what are the answers? Work done by applied force during displacement. Applied force is 200 newtons multiplied by this positive work done. It is very simple to get it. Right? Again, here is a small problem in the question. We are assuming here that these two blocks do not move with respect to each other. So there must be static friction between them. Now, they have not told whether the static friction is maximum or not. You have to find out whether it is maximum or not. Have they assumed it to be maximum, or they have done something that would have told you? I told you, if they have to move as one system, take them as one, find out the maximum acceleration, and then find out from that maximum acceleration what is the force acting on the block. If it is less than the static friction, they are moving together. If it is more than the static friction, then the blocks must be moving apart, different from each other. And as I can see, what they have done, total mass is 20 kgs, total force is 100 newtons, so the acceleration will be 5 newtons. And if you put that, the total acceleration will be 5 meter per second square, and if you put that 5 meter per second square, you will get the value of Fs as mu mg. Do we understand this? Can I have some reason that we understand this? Well done. See, that is how we put into use what we had done in the previous chapter here. You can remember it. That is where you can excel with respect to others. So yeah, they found out the value. They move together. So work done by A on B or B on A, they are giving the answer as zero. But again, they have given the answer zero with respect to what? Work done by internal static friction is zero. Net work done is zero. See, now since this problem has come, let me elaborate more on this problem. Now, if I am sitting on ground, remember, I am sitting on ground, what do I see? I see that they both move together. Now, static friction, you can all do the different understand. Static friction on block A will be forward. Static friction on block B would be backwards. They are moving together. Both of them are doing both of them are getting displaced by the same amount. The displacement is same. On block A, static friction is doing positive work. Same work in the negative is being done by static friction on body B. So work done by static friction in this case on body A is positive. Work done by static friction on body B in this case is negative. I'm standing from here. Total work done, which I will see, done by static friction, which is again an internal force, is zero. Do we understand this? Work done by static friction, which is an internal force, is zero with respect to ground frame. With respect to ground frame. Now let me get up and get on the frame of this body. And now let me see what is the work done by static friction on block A. Now when I'm standing on block A and block A and B are moving together, I don't see any motion. I don't see any motion. I don't see any displacement. Work done is dependent on the frame of reference. I don't see any motion. I don't see any displacement. So work done by block A on block B is zero. Work done by B on A is also zero. Net work is still zero. Are you getting my point? Net work done by static friction is zero. Getting my point? So remember that. Okay. Chalo. Now, but when it becomes kinetic friction, then the net work done by kinetic friction in whatever way you find it will be coming out negative. I have sent you this sheet. I think try to do problem number 28, which is based on a similar principle. But here, when frictional force stop acting, when the velocity becomes equal, so there is a case when there is static friction between them. There is a case when there is kinetic friction between them. And this question will tell you very nicely what is the difference between the two. So you do this question. I'll just move on ahead. Work done by pseudo force. There might be some cases in which you are sitting on an accelerated frame and then you are trying to find out the work done. How do you find the work done by the pseudo force? This is a very good example. Example number 32, which you will do and understand. A block of mass M is pulled by a force F is equal to 100 Newton. It covers a distance of 500 meters in 10 seconds from initial point. This motion is observed by three observers, A, B, and C. Observer number A, standing on ground, velocity is zero, acceleration is zero. Observer number B, velocity is 10 meter per second, acceleration is zero. Observer number C, velocity is zero, acceleration is 10 meter per second square. Let us see what is the work done as seen by three different bodies. Because work done depends on reference frame. I kept on telling you this is the best example that I can have for this. Do we have this? Work done with respect to A. A is not moving, not accelerating. He will see the total displacement as 500 meters. The total force that he is seeing is 100 newtons. 500 multiplied by 100. You gave 50,000 joules. I hope you agree on this. Work done with respect to block B. Block B is moving with a constant velocity of 10 meter per second. So he will also move in 10 seconds. So with respect to him, what will be the displacement? 500 minus 10 into 10, 500 minus 100, 400. And therefore the work done by, as seen by him, will be 40,000 joules. The third gentleman is actually the same gentleman who is sitting on top of him, the same acceleration, on an accelerated frame, and he does not see any work because he does not see any displacement. Is there any work done by in all the three cases? The work done by the 100 Newton force is there. It is doing, otherwise the block will not move. But when you are sitting on that accelerated frame, the work done disappears. Where is that work done gone? How will you account for that? Why are you not able to see that work? where this work done has gone. In case number B, it is easier to understand. Sir, I have moved. Work acts on us also. Dixit, no. The better way of saying this is, you are on an accelerated frame. And when you get on an accelerated frame, life becomes tough. Because then you start to see something different. And Newton's laws and everything. If Newton's laws is not valid, how will you find out work done? So then you have to apply pseudo forces and all that stuff. That work done is again the pseudo force because you are on a accelerated frame, and you know you are not seeing the world as the world is. You are seeing a different world. Getting my point, Dixit? That is where you can account for that work done. Work done by internal force. Sum of work done by internal force will be always zero, but that does not mean that the sum of kinetic energy will also be equal to zero. Because kinetic energy is never negative, it's always positive. Work energy theorem, I hope you all know this. We can also call it work kinetic energy theorem. And it simply says that work done by all forces, this is the way I write it, work done by all forces, whether they are conservative, non-conservative, spring, gravity, will be equal to change in kinetic energy. Okay. Now, this work energy theorem, as I always call, is mother theorem. Whether the force is conservative or not, non-conservative, conservative, valid for everyone. You can have a daughter theorem. The daughter theorem is known as law of conservation of mechanical work. Mechanical work? Law of conservation of mechanical energy. If there are only conservative forces working on the system, the energy always remains constant. Sometimes it is changed into potential energy, sometimes it is changed into kinetic energy, sometimes it is some energy in potential energy form, some energy in kinetic energy form. Any question that can be done with this law of conservation of mechanical energy can definitely be done by work energy theorem, because work energy theorem is the mother theorem. This is the daughter theorem. This is same as impulse momentum theorem. Impulse momentum theorem is the mother theorem. Law of conservation of linear momentum is the daughter theorem. Angular impulse, angular momentum theorem is the mother theorem. Law of conservation of angular momentum is the daughter theorem. Mother, daughter, mother is valid everywhere. Daughter is only valid when there are certain conditions. In this case, the condition is only conservative forces working. Do we understand this? Can I have some reason that we understand this? There are some simple examples that are given here. Example number 33, 34. I hope you can do these examples very simple. These are very simple examples. I don't think you can do it in any way. Yes, let me do this just for example, because these type of questions may trouble you. When this law of work energy principle is applied on pulleys, it might create trouble because it might look different, because you are not asking accelerations here, you are asking velocities here. The mass at M1 and M2 are released from rest. Use work energy theorem, find out the velocity of the two blocks when they move a distance x. You can always find it out. You can always find their acceleration. And acceleration is constant, v square is equal to u square plus 2s. Whenever you apply v square is equal to u square plus 2s, this is work energy theorem for constant force. That is the work energy theorem for constant force. Remember that. And constant force is conservative, does not depend on path. So no matter how you go, it remains same. So you can easily do it. Work done by all forces equal to change in kinetic energy. You can call it work done, or you can do it since there are only conservative forces. There is one non-conservative force working here, which is tension probably. But tension again is constant, so that constant force is again conservative, does not depend on path. Whatever work tension does on this, the same work in the opposite direction tension will do on this. So work done by tension will cancel, so don't worry about tension. The only conservative force working here is the gravity force, gravitational force. Work done by gravitational force can be thought of as energy. So total energy at one point will be equal to total energy at the other point. At the point number one, it only has potential energy. At point number two, it will have a sum of potential and kinetic energy, or whatever way you think it. You can get the answer. Do you understand this? So I'm assuming that this has gone down. I mean, they are assuming that this has gone down, this has gone up. If you take this as the medium level, potential energy zero, which has gone down will have negative energy minus m1gx. The one which has gone up will have potential positive energy plus m2gx. You can now use it. Whether you want to do it as work energy theorem, or you want to do it as law of conservation of mechanical energy. At this point, the total mechanical energy is zero. At the other point, potential energy of one is this one. Potential energy of two is this one. kinetic energy of 1 is half m1 v square, kinetic energy of 2 is half m2 v square, and this is the way you can solve the question. Yes or no? Here they have given m2 is greater than m1. I have taken it ulta, so I have to take it like this. Okay. Am I clear or am I going too fast for you to understand this? I hope I'm making my point clear in how you got to do this, because you already have this, so you don't have to worry. Example number 38. Now remember this u, it does not depend on how you have shown this. V is always equal to u square plus 2g h ka root. Shayad I told you in the previous class when motion in 1D or 2D we were doing. I think I gave you in this example. This is a good example of how to find out the speed using law of conservation of energy. Power is the rate at which energy is spent. There are two types of power. You can call one as instantaneous power. There's instantaneous power can be written as F dot V. I hope the same thing is written in the notes. Instantaneous power is written as F dot V. Then we have power average. Power average is total work. So integral of dW divided by integral of dt. You can also write it as integral of P instantaneous dt divided by integral of dt. Do we know this, right? This is the average power. This F dot V is the instantaneous power. I hope it is written like this. This is instantaneous power. And this one is average power. I think average power is mentioned. Units of power, you know this. Okay, it's no point of going through this. This you should be able to do it. You can do this one. Example number 41. A stone is projected with a velocity at an angle theta with the horizontal. Find out the average power of gravity during time t. Total work divided by total time. So you find out the total work done by gravity divided by time t. Instantaneous power due to gravitational force. Instantaneous power ke liye you must do F dot V. Gravity force is always downwards, minus mg into j hat. Velocity at any point is V cos theta I hat plus V sin theta j hat. You just dot it and you will get your answers. Don't worry. Don't take any tension. When is the average power zero? Average power zero. How will you get average power zero? When is the average power zero? The question is wrong. When is the average power zero? The question is asked in a wrong way. It must be asked in such a way that between what time is the average power zero? From what time to what time is the average power zero? So when do we have the total work done, then the average power will be zero, because gravity is a conservative force. So you start from one point and come to the same point on the same horizontal plane, the average power will be zero. Yes or no? Do we understand this? We understand this or not? It goes up, the power, the work done by gravity or average power will be negative. When it comes down, it will be positive. So from where to where the average power is going to be zero, from zero to that time of flight. Do you understand this? When is the instantaneous power zero? When they are perpendicular, so that is at the highest point. When is the instantaneous power negative? When is the instantaneous power positive? I think you can understand it. From base to highest point, it is negative. From highest point to base, it is positive. Then you have potential energy. I've already told you potential energy is associated with a conservative force. What I'll do is probably I'll take one more lecture here on this one and do some questions on this, because I think that this is the point that you can solve. We'll do some question of this also, this rope and this thing. So I'll probably take one class. I'll probably skip your rotational wala part. I'll just do a simple recap of rotation in very short one class, because there's no point of losing there, because you will not be able to solve any question if it comes in JEE Advanced. JEE Mains I think is already over. How was your mains? I mean, have you done your mains or there is still remaining? Tell me. My class from my end is over. If you have any doubts, you can ask.